Hi guys, I'm here in the Stadsfeestzaal in Antwerp. Very nice, restorated, old, big party room. That has become a shopping center. And it's on the Meer, the biggest shopping street here in Antwerp. Very nice, cold, but very nice right now because it's winter. But I want to give you guys an update on the coins. I've been doing a lot in the buying department, and well, the biggest news is that I don't have any bitcoins anymore, a few for expenses, but nothing as an investment really. And that's the first time in since 2012. That's 5 years ago. So, and I invested actually a lot in different altcoins, and I have chosen to follow the lead of Frank, who has a website, Blue Magic Capital. You can find it on bluemagic.info, where he shares different portfolios, all focused on altcoins. And he has been doing that very well. I really like that he diversifies over different projects, and he is very good at not buying any pumped coins. He doesn't do that. He only buys, well, undervalued coins. Of course, that's a subjective thing, but he has had great results the past 2 years, and I chose to follow for the remaining bitcoins that I had. I put in his I'm following his portfolios. That makes it easy for me because I don't have to research all these projects and judge them. Also don't have to decide when to buy or sell. I leave that to him. And he has invested in several projects, game, credits, made safe, factum, also decrit, and a lot of smaller coins too, black coin, florin coin, huge bucks or something. Like, it's like 10-15 coins, so I'm very happy with that, and I really think that I should probably have a little bit of Bitcoin, but I will, when I get a chance, take out some Bitcoin from this portfolio or from my other altcoin investments. Byteball, NXT, Clumps. If any of those goes up enough, I will probably take some money off the table and have again some bitcoins. But at this point in time, I really think that the opportunity is there, and not in Bitcoin. I actually sold some Bitcoin also for gold. I had about 6% gold, and now I have 10% gold in my portfolio. Just because I decided to sell some gold, I sold a lot, all my assets over the past few years in exchange for Bitcoin and altcoins, but I only had some gold left, and then I decided even to start selling a piece of that when Bitcoin was around $220 or so, but I made the pledge to buy back that gold when Bitcoin would be out of its bear market, and that clearly has happened the past 2 years. It has recovered to the all-time high now of around $1,000. It's now $900. But it has been going up to $1,100 a couple of weeks back corrected, and now it's back at 900. But I still think the chances are very high Bitcoin will breach its all-time high and go into a new bubble this year, 2017. But I think the risk has gone up a lot in Bitcoin due to the leadership taking the wrong decisions, and I think a lot of people in the cryptocurrency community are not in touch with reality. They say these coins are decentralized, Bitcoin is decentralized, but Bitcoin is future. It fully depends on the decisions made by the leadership. But this is not a sure thing. I agree with Roger Ver and many others, actually, that Mike Hearn, Olivier Janssens, and there are some other people, even Gavin Andreessen, used to be project lead of Bitcoin, thinks it's the wrong decision to not scale up the block size, and I agree with that. Of course, it's true that the amount of nodes will go down a lot if you do that. Now we're about 5,000 nodes. This will drop a lot because once you allow the block size to continue to increase, the blockchain becomes too big, and it becomes much more expensive to run a node, and so Bitcoin becomes more centralized as hobbyists will drop off. And that is true, but Bitcoin is already very very centralized due to its mining system with the proof of work. So, I mean, that's already the case. So now it's already the case. So, but due to this decision, suddenly the transaction fees are starting to go up a lot. So now you have both. You have a centralized mining. Bitcoin is already centralized, and you have high fees. That's just like not good. Then you can better have just Bitcoin is centralized, and you have low fees or no fees. That's better. That will allow for a continued adoption, because in the world of investing, and as when you run a business, you cannot be complacent. And I've been complacent many times and lost a lot of money due to that, thinking. Having your head in the sand and not being in touch with the reality of your business adoption or your coin adoption and the growth statistics. You always have to look at the statistics, at the hard data. And for Bitcoin, this looks bad. The transactions are not going up as much anymore at all as before. And they have topped out due to technical limitations. This is just absolutely unacceptable. It's extremely poor decision making, and so they're giving the market away. And I will just and I agree with that. That's my opinion, and that's how I act. And so, yeah, the opportunity is elsewhere. Of course, this is very like. We are leading a certain scene, so we know this, but the masses don't know this. The masses only know Bitcoin. If they know anything, it's just Bitcoin. And so there are a lot of people that know Bitcoin but haven't bought it yet. So that's why I believe we will get a new bubble. Prices will continue to go up, and adoption will also continue to go up. But you will see a very big overflow into altcoins from existing Bitcoiners and from newcomers. And people are like Roger Ver, he invested 1%, only 1% of his Bitcoin portfolio into altcoins, a few privacy coins like Monero and Zcash and Zcoin. But that's only 1%. I think people like him will end up investing a lot more in altcoins because that's the only thing they can really do. They can't really they are trying to influence the leadership of Bitcoin to change course and don't and increase the block size. But it's been going on. It's been going on for a couple of years now, and I think I also understand from the perspective of the leadership of Bitcoin that they choose to go this route. The problem with these people is, I think it's Adam Beck that took over the leadership of Gavin Andreessen, but then he didn't really want to be the only leader, so he involved two or four other people, and so they take decisions together. And so they don't want that pressure on them to decide, I think, about to have so much pressure on them. And the best way to do this is to basically don't let it grow anymore. That's the only thing they can do. Do nothing. And then it won't grow anymore. Because if they do nothing, there was already a block size limit, well, then it won't grow as much anymore. And so you will have a lot of other players in the market, and then the pressure on them will become a lot less. But the market capitalization will also be a lot less of Bitcoin versus the other coins. It will continue to go up, but the other coins will go up a lot more. And so right now it's like 80-90% is Bitcoin in the cryptocurrency market. This is like coming to an end. I'm so sure of that. I've sold all my Bitcoins, because like, you can continue to be a very strong leader if you make the right decisions, like Facebook has been doing for a long time, and Google and Microsoft has also done for 20 years, but then start to make wrong decisions, and it already lost a lot of leadership. So you can continue to have like the dominant lead, but only when you have strong social network effect and you take the right decisions. And I think both of them are lacking in Bitcoin. It does not have a strong network effect because it's too easy to switch to something else. A strong network effect is like at the time with the Microsoft operating system, you can't switch to something else because it was incompatible. You couldn't start using Apple, but Apple was not compatible with Microsoft, so it was just not an option for many people. The common users, it was not an option. Over the years, compatibility has increased in these operating systems, and that's why Microsoft has also lost its network effect and lost market share. It's mostly due to innovations, of course, that it lost its market share. It was incapable of launching phones or tablets, and so others took that market, and at the same time the operating system too. And today, many more people are running their needs on Android or Apple than on Microsoft, because most people don't use a desktop, and even laptops, or most people use phones. So I think the same will happen with Bitcoin. Bitcoin is very, very unuser-friendly. It is now also becoming expensive. It's not possible to pay for a coffee if you have to pay a fee of 20 cents to pay like a $3 item. It's way too much. So they decided to not, like, it's just like the dream of 3 years ago is not going to happen. The dream that Bitcoin will become a mainstream currency, it's over. But it's not priced in yet. Bitcoin is valued at 15 billion, and many other coins that do have the potential to become a mainstream currency are not even valued at 100 million, so 150 times less. So that's of course where the opportunity is. Of course, the big challenge is to choose the right coins, because many of them will fail. So that's why I've learned the hard way to diversify. I used to invest everything on NXT Ardor and some clumps, but that was very wrong. Now I'm diversified over like probably 15 coins or so. And you can't buy coins that have pumped already. I made the decision just recently again with Monero. I decided to basically sell again three quarters of my position. And so because I do like Monero very much, and I hope I can invest a lot more in it in the future, but the opportunity is not there right now because it just went up versus Bitcoin times five or so from its all-time high. So it used to be around 20, actually for a very long time, for 2 years since it was created in 2014. It was around, I don't know the exact amount, but it was something with a two. It went to first to three, then to two, then to one, then to two again for a long time, to three again, and then it breached its all-time high of three, and now it's at 13 versus Bitcoin. So it is not expensive versus Bitcoin. No, certainly not. but it is expensive versus many other coins that don't have all this positive news and don't have all this exposure. I'm talking about all the projects I've been investing in. You have to look on bluemagic.info to see all those coins. But also the coins I was invested in. Arder, NXT, Clumps, they are depressed coins. Actually now Arder has started to go up, so that's very nice, from 1,200 Satoshi to now 2,500 Satoshi. The past few weeks it doubled. The same for Decred that I also have been recommending. It was at 50 and now it's at 150, also times 3. And the same for Byteball that I have also been recommending. It was at 10 and now it's at 40, times 4 versus Bitcoin, all these 3. So it seems that this year might be my year when it comes to the altcoins, because the past 2 years has been a total failure. I only made money with Bitcoin, lost a lot with altcoins. So I hope that I can make up for all these losses this year. And then if that works out, I am going to... I hope to have also a decent stash in Bitcoin and an even bigger stash in Monero. I also bought some Zcash, but my timing is wrong. And so right now I only have like 2-3% in Monero, 2-1% in Zcash. Because I know these coins, they are the future, I think. But in price, it's just not interesting. And a good investor needs to have both. A project that has a lot of potential, but also a price that is right. What else? I'm thinking if I can say anything else about the cryptocurrencies. I don't think so. I think I've said it all. Yeah, just about Bitcoin. So Bitcoin is not decentralized, it's centralized. It's fully dependent on a few miners and fully dependent on a few developers. And this is not the case, for example, for gold. Gold really is decentralized because nobody can fuck that up. It doesn't matter even what presidents decide to do. They can't destroy the value of Bitcoin. It doesn't matter what miners decide or what exchanges decide. Is gold a great investment? I don't think so. But at these prices, it's not a bad investment either. It's something very different than cryptocurrency. It's actually money. Even though it's much less money than euros and US dollars, that's real. That's money, because you can use it everywhere. And that seems to be not coming to an end just yet, because if I look, for example, at payments in shops, Bitcoin was really taking the lead with its QR code payment system. But to these days, it has basically lost its lead, and many payment providers are coming to market. The big banks, they're all getting wising up and starting to offer mobile wallets with easy and free ways to pay each other and to pay shops. So, but still, I think there will be cryptocurrencies that succeed in innovating also on the payment level and become actually more user-friendly than fiat, than cash or bank payments, but it's not Bitcoin. So what else did I want to say? That's why I invest a little bit back also in gold. The risk reward is not as good at all in gold, but it is something decent to store some value away for if times would become bad again. You have something to you have the reserves. Huh? But for me, these reserves are very small. It's only 20% of my portfolio. 80% is in cryptocurrency. So, I am taking very high risk, but by diversifying now over like 15 coins or so, my risk, and also following someone who has the discipline that I have not proven to have in the past, to only buy the pressed coins, don't buy anything that has pumped or started pumping already, and also sell when it's pumping, when it's being hyped, when it's in the hype, you should be selling. And this, some people have it, others not. I have it only half. I used to not have it at all, so I'm getting there, but I don't have it fully. Like, I just get this, they call it FOMO, fear of missing out. I just had it recently with Monero, and so I end up buying that. And I did the same with NXT, and I did the same with Clumps. I bought it at levels much higher than today, and that's the best way to lose money, is to start buying something that suddenly comes on the scene, is already in the top 10. Everybody is talking about it. Yeah, don't buy that. That's rule number one of investing. What else? I'm also just from far away looking at non-crypto investments. Like for example, Apple. I haven't seen the market cap, but I see that this brand is losing a lot of market share, and I think the history will repeat, and that they will lose again. Like in the start with Apple computers and IBM, Apple had the market, the majority of the market, and then IBM came on the scene and they lost it all. From like a market dominance of 80% or so to a market dominance of 70% to like 1% over 20 years. And then Steve Jobs came back and he basically innovated something new like the iPhone, and that then they had again a market share of 80% or so, and now it's dropping, and I think the same will happen again. It will drop again to 1% because I see that even Apple consumers are starting to become not happy with their product anymore. Twitter is also an interesting story. I think it's been getting a lot of beatings. It has dropped a lot in market cap, but it's still like 10 billion or so. But it seems that, and then Facebook is, I don't know how much, but a couple of 100 billion. But I start to use Twitter more than Facebook. Even the president of the United States is tweeting these days and actually using that as a communication channel. So maybe there's an opportunity there, but I haven't digged deep into this. But I think from time to time, I'm not really like into these markets, so this is very probably naive thinking that is not well researched. But from time to time, I do think there are opportunities there. For example, maybe to short Apple, Twitter, maybe not buying yet, but keeping an eye on. But Tesla, for example, I had been studying, and I should have invested when I saw the potential. I didn't, and it tenfolded. But now the valuation of Tesla is way above those of BMW or Volkswagen, if you compare the production numbers, and it's already all priced in the market, there is no opportunity there, I think, anymore. So, and something more I have to tell on Byteball. Byteball is very interesting, but so there is a new distribution soon, and the 11th of February, but the lead dev said that he would distribute like 10% of the coins every 2 months or so, and so after a year all coins would be on market, but he has changed his plans, and now he decided on the second distribution to only distribute about 2% of the coins, and it depends how many bitcoins participate, but this is a lot lower than the first round, because that was 10%, and half of those coins will be distributed to existing Byteball owners, so it's basically only 1%. If 100,000 bitcoins would register, the first round it was 70,000, let's say it goes up to 100,000, then only 1% more, 1% of the Byteball coins will come to market. That's an inflation of 10-15%, because there's 10% on market plus 1-2% is like 12%, but it's a lot lower, and that's why I think the price has gone up of Byteball. But it could be a good strategy of the lead dev to it doesn't make sense from, like, you want to reward early adopters more than later adopters. He's giving away the coins for free, but if you look at the valuation of the coin, now it's about 5 million altcoins in circulation. But when he distributed them, there was of course no value because it was the first distribution. But if you look at the first market prices, it was about 8 times less. It was a 5 and now it's 40. And so the value of what he basically gave away, the market decided at first that the value of this was about 1 million US dollars. And right now he's going to distribute like, if this 2%, and at the current market cap of 5 million for 10%, that's also about 1 million or so. So if you look at the value is giving away, it's about the same in the second round, but because the coin in the meantime has gone up a lot, it is a lot less coins. But if he continues this process, it might also succeed, even though it's a lot less coins, it's the same value he's giving away for free, and more people will probably hear about it and participate, and so more and more people will get free coins. But his opinion or philosophy is that people do need to put in some work to get those free coins, and so you have to register your Bitcoin, but people that have Byteball and didn't move them can just leave them there, and they will get for each 1 gigabyte you will get 0.1 gigabyte free coins. But if you also link them, you will get also free black bytes. So when you put in some work, you get some more. I think I've been lucky that I still had bitcoins when the distribution the first one was, because now I don't have any anymore. But luckily I have Byteball, and you have two in Byteball. You have whites and you have blacks. You have they call it GB gigabytes, but you also have GBB, that is black gigabytes. And so the market value of the whites GB is now about 40, but the market the value of the GBB, the black ones, is about 1/5 of that or so per GBB, so that's about a 5. But for every there are 2.1111 more black bytes in circulation than white bytes, and so the total market cap of there are now 100,000 gigabytes whites in circulation, and that's is about $4 million worth now, and you also have then not 100 but 211,000 black gigabytes, and the market cap of that is then about 1-2 million right now. And so the blacks are for private transactions. The transaction is not shared with the network as wide as when you send white bytes, it's shared with the network fully, but not with black bytes. You need to pair up your device with the other person via the chat, and only then you can exchange coins. But for me, this is all very technical. But I think actually that it is pretty cheap still, because it's only valued at 5 million. And for example, IOTA, the other DAG coin, is valued at 25 million or so. So it's valued five times higher, but I think they can have the same valuation because they both are projects with great potential. They can both fail, but they can both succeed big. They each have their strengths. They each have different approaches to certain problems. I would like to invest some in IOTA, actually. I'm starting to become more open to that, because in the past, I really made a big mistake by investing only in NXT and then not in Ethereum. And I was also looking at some other projects, the Mastercoin, Counterparty. I should have invested a little in all and some more in the ones I like, and I would have done better. Even though Counterparty dropped 10 times more than NXT, and Mastercoin, now called Omni, dropped also 10 times more than NXT, Ethereum went up, 20 times more, or no, 30 times more than NXT, and actually was the one that made great profits and would have made up for all the other investments. So it does make sense to diversify. So for that reason, I'm thinking of putting something in IOTA too. So I hope you guys enjoyed the video. Check out the website of Frank. It's called the block. It's called Magic. I will put the link below. bluemagic.info. He writes weekly reports on his portfolio, and it's very interesting. He also has a thread on Bitcoin Talk. His username is there, Vulture Fund, he also has on Telegram a trading chat. If you really want to follow this intensively, you can talk with the guys there. But you could just keep it simple and just copy some of his positions, and from time to time check his websites and see the latest updates. Voila. Let's hope 2017 becomes a great year for all of us, and I wish you all a great day. Bye.